approved minutes from April 20.
I don't have minutes done, so that'll have to be for the next time.
Okay, what do we got? Any minutes?
No minutes.
No minutes to approve. Okay, scheduled appointment, 6 o'clock, Lynn Sibley.
Went out to borrow for the fire truck, and the low bid was at 2.29% for interest. And it's with Greenfield Cooperative.
Okay.
Savings Bank. So I have some notes for you to sign.
Great.
Okay.
That's 5 years?
It's 5 years, yeah. So you're going to sign in these blocks on each one of these notes.
You said what, 0.9?
Really? Is this 79?
79,000.
It's 79,000 a year.
A year.
Oh. So each note is for a year. And then there's that section.
Are we committed for 5 years, or can we prepay if you want?
Normally you can prepay. I didn't ask on this one, but normally you can.
What was the interest rate?
2.29. And I did have one other thing about petty cash. I'm finding that $50, I have a petty cash of $50, but during tax collection season, when people come in with 20s and everything,
oh, yeah.
I don't have enough to make the change without running to the bank every day to make change. So I was wondering if you might be willing to raise that to $100. Okay, there needs to be something official from the select board to the town accountant. In order to do that, so.
Something official.
Yeah,
like
just a letter. Yeah, okay. That says that petty cash will be raised. The only thing I use that for is an occasional postage purchase.
Yeah.
Or to make change out of it.
Are you okay with that, friend? Raising petty cash
to what?
100
from
50.
50.
Sure.
There you go.
Okay. Here it is. Thank you.
Okay. Tony Barshansky and Ed Farrick, Private Culvert.
Keith, do you want to?
Why don't I
start this one?
Give you each of you an app of what we've got, what we're talking about.
This looks familiar.
Yes, we've been discussed before.
Yeah.
The pinkish color, as you look at it on the right-hand side, is the drainage that's mostly in question at the moment, and that is as it starts on the south side of Christian Lane, in between the property line of Mr. Barshansky and Mr. Farrick.
Yep.
It then runs underneath. When it gets to the road, it enters into a 15-inch Orangeburg culvert,
mm-hmm.
goes underneath the road, perpendicular to the road. When it gets to the other side, it goes into a concrete structure like a manhole, turns and comes out of that at an angle and heads to the northeast, a short distance to where I have that little line in. That's an approximate location. None of this is really to scale. And end somewhere on Mr. Farrick's property. From there, it runs through an open ditch all the way down to where it would cross Long Plain Road and go underneath Long Plain Road through the Wojcicki property. The situation that Mr. Barshansky is come to the town, Paul, you probably remember this, this has been discussed before. I can't remember the exact outcome other than I think it was, at that time was left that the property owners were going to take care of it, but it's back before us again. And so the board has to decide at this point in time, for me to do anything there, it's outside of the town's layout.
Right.
And it's on private property.
Right.
The issue is, I'm not going to go and do anything on private property without the Board of Selectmen telling me to do it. In doing so, I feel it's the same scenario as before. I would caution us to be a precedent setting in the aspect of having to then answer to someone who says, how come you won't clean mine out because you cleaned out his?
That's, right. Or if something untoward happens as a result of your actions, then the town is responsible.
Then that's potential response, correct.
Yeah, okay.
So that's what I have to offer in a nutshell. I don't know if the two residents want to offer anything more in regards to that.
What's the size of the pipe once it...
Where it exits, I believe it's like 8 to 10 inches. It is somewhere along that way, and again, nobody knows where it is. It steps down. When we inspected it, whatever, it was close to like 2 years ago, when we inspected it and we dug open that manhole, everything was perfect in the town's layout. There was no obstructions or anything like that.
There's a manhole in the street above the culvert.
Yeah, if you look at that plan, basically where it takes the left-hand turn, there's the structure. It's still within the town's layout. Now, you got to remember, when you look at like Christian Lane, that is 50 feet wide. That's the town's layout. So you're not really looking at the roadway.
Oh, okay.
The roadway is half of that within inside of that layout. So that layout is 50 feet, of which we have 22 feet.
So there's 12 and a half on each side.
Roughly. Yep.
So what are you proposing to do now?
I'm suggesting, and you guys need to make that decision, that I don't see that it's a responsibility of the town to go and do. However, I don't make that final decision.
What are you going to do? You haven't told us. What are you proposing to do?
I'm proposing that I don't need, that I shouldn't do anything.
Because
it's not in the town's layout. It's on private property.
Okay, but if you were to do something, what needs to be done here to correct?
If you were to correct it to start with, at the very least, you would have to clean the ditch out. That would be the first thing. Then at the same point in time, I would also recommend going back, digging in back towards that manhole to find out how far back it was, why it was, trying to come up with a reason why it was reduced. And that's holding back the water also.
So the problem is the water's not getting off of lots 36 and 38. It's ponding.
It definitely floods property number 36. Backs up on Mr. Barshewski's, and he's had water.
Okay, and it floods because the drainage is inadequate.
No, I wouldn't say it's inadequate. It's not being maintained.
And it's
I feel that the culvert under the road
is
adequate.
Okay.
Just the system that was put in originally was adequate. At some point in time, nobody knows. There again, no one has an answer. The pipe was added on and probably utilized what the homeowner is, my guess, is what they had. But nobody knows. Somebody somewhere added on, reduced the size of the culvert.
So we have a 15-inch culvert under the road, right?
Correct.
And front of
when
the
it
road,
comes out of that manhole, it's still 15 inches and heads towards the open ditch.
Yes, lot 3411.
Correct.
And that is, the open ditch is in yellow.
No, the open ditch is another, I'm going to talk about, that's another.
That's another open ditch.
That I wanted to talk about as long as we're here.
But if you were to do any kind of corrective measure, you'd be on lots 3411 and 37.
Correct, of which I don't know where, without somebody establishing that property line, I don't know where that is.
So the water doesn't pond on the south side, it ponds on the north side of Christian Lane?
Correct.
So the people that have an issue with that...
No. The water is ponding
on your property.
On the south side of Christian Lane.
South side?
Yes. Correct.
Okay, that's what I thought.
And like I said, that backs up, and it backs up all the way to 33 and 35, all back out there.
And the source of the backup, the congestion, is where that arrow is in lot 3411?
Yes.
So a little bit through...
It's somewhere between that.
And a little bit to 34, somewhere. And that, is that an open ditch, or is that...
The pipe terminates, and right now, when you see the end of the pipe, it's... The outfall is, the water has to come out and go straight up.
Well, that's a problem.
Well, it's a... Like I say, approximately 10 years ago and everything, the pipe was not level with the ground. It was up. And water fell down, and it flowed down the ditch. But over the last 10 years or so, sediment or whatever has gotten in there, and now the pipe is right on the ground, and the water has got to come up anywhere between 18 and 24 inches before it'll start flowing down the ditch.
So it seems to me, then, that the pipe has to be elevated. No?
I think it's...
The pipe is...
We've got to get rid of it.
The ditch has to be dug out.
If you elevate the pipe, then you need to replace...
That's not going to...
You cannot change...
Because the pipe hasn't changed in elevation. What's happened is the ditch has
been... The sediment ends up...
So the ditch has to be cleaned out by whoever's land it's on, right?
Well, that's where we're here for.
Well, that's what seems to be the...
Mr. Ferrick has asked that the town... do the work.
But it's not the town's ditch.
Well, that's what...
So, Mr. Ferrick, it seems to me like the ditch isn't just on your property, it's also on property 3411, which I imagine that there's congestion there, sedimentation there also, in these two properties.
To a certain extent. After you go a ways, it takes the slope increases, and so...
So how much is involved in cleaning out the ditch?
It's not a lot.
Well?
Time-wise, if you just were to clean the ditch out, you're probably talking an hour.
An hour with a backhoe or something?
Yeah. I am not arguing that it's not a lot of time involved. It's just the issue is, before I go do it, I just want...
Oh, I'm not saying we should do
okay,
it
well,
necessarily.
I'm just, all right, well, I'm
it's
just
not our land, so.
But why haven't the property owners done anything with this?
Pardon me?
Why haven't, I guess, Wachaleski and Ferrick are the property owners where the ditch is, it needs to be cleaned. Why haven't they done anything?
Like you say, I've kept my side so that the water will flow on the south side of the ditch and everything, but once it gets underneath Bridgeton Lane and it gets choked down to that 8 inches, water just starts backing up. And like I say, I have had issues with water in my basement, at least 4 issues with water in my basement. And with the major renovation that I just did, I'm worried that it's gonna happen again.
Well, that sounds reasonable. Mr. Ferrick, why not just clean the sediment out of the ditch? You and your neighbor, Wachaleski.
You think that will correct it all?
Well, that's what Keith seems to think, and that's what seems to me to be the case.
I think we got to get rid of that 8-inch pipe, too, and have it all 15-inch going through there.
Yep, so wait, where the 8-inch pipe, it comes from the culvert into lot 37 and 34? Is that...
From the other side. Somewhere where...
But it's not on the south side.
It starts from here to here.
Somewhere in this area.
So it's buried?
It steps down. It could be 10 feet. It could be 30 feet, 40 feet. It's hard to say.
So let's put in a 15-inch pipe, or somebody should put in a 15-inch pipe,
You
right?
might be able to just take it out, and if it's not that far back towards the road, just leave it more open ditch.
Okay.
So that you don't have to spend money to purchase any pipe.
Well,
again, that would be up to the property owner to, again, as I look at it, and if I have to make an educated guess, I would presume that at some point in time, it was added on to make more use of the land, to basically enclose the ditch. Mm-hmm. And probably was what was available or what someone had on hand to do it at that time.
Okay, so you're saying that if we just get rid of that pipe, which is a constriction.
You could, as long as this doesn't go way back to the point of where the Mr. Ferrick's property is growing, you know, being landscaped grass-wise. After it could be just in that rough overburden.
And that would take care of the problem.
You could possibly just eliminate that restricted pipe and clean a ditch out and everybody be happy.
So that seems like a good solution. Yes? No?
I felt that it was a town's responsibility as to what has been caused, and it's still, the culvert is still town property, right?
Right, the culvert is under the road. In the right of way of the road. So the culvert is town property, but it doesn't seem like the culvert's the problem. Seems like the smaller pipe is the problem, which emanates from beyond town property.
Well, yeah. Keith, has it been determined where that restriction is? Is it possible that it's underneath the right of way where it restricts?
I do not believe so, and because where the manhole, if you want to call it now, where it enters that structure and then leaves, and that's 15-inch leaving, so. Again, I don't know, other than trying to make a best educated guess as to where the layout is.
So there's not enough room to get down in the manhole and measure back or look back?
You can't get down in there to see without putting like a camera in there. No. It's a narrow.
So what if the landowners clean up where it's clearly sedimented, whatever the word is, silted up? And then after that's done, we can take a better look at what's under the road, and if that's a problem,
I know the road is clear. That we've inspected.
Okay, what's under the road is clear.
Definitely 100%.
So what's on town's property is clear.
Yes. Well, other than maybe out at the very edge, I don't know where it restricts down.
Okay,
but one thing I've noticed in that location on the road, you've got a spillway or a gutter or whatever that drains water from the road into that ditch on the south side, right?
Yes.
And with you, with the town paving Christian Lane, I assume you're going to do something to maintain that gutter or whatever spillway into that ditch, which could increase water going into that ditch, causing it some possible backup. Is that something that, I mean, is that a reasonable assumption that you're gonna get more water in there? You're gonna, I assume, improve that gutter that goes into there. It's only, what, 6 or 8 inches?
I'm not gonna be increasing the water, no. Because I'm not changing any geographic, I'm not creating an area where more square footage can be running into it. It'll be the same amount of water that's running.
Okay, but there is water running into that now. There is town.
Correct.
Town water.
I'm saying it'll be the same amount now. It'll be the same amount when we get done than it is now.
Okay, but when there's a major storm in the area and water running down that gutter into the ditch, is that what's causing the backup?
No, I think that the backup is being caused by it being choked down on the other side. Like I say, the water has to come up at least 2 feet to be able to flow down the ditch.
Okay.
On your side.
On the north side.
So this has not always been a problem, correct?
Well, it's continued to get worse.
It's continued, but at some point when that culvert was put in by the town, it drained the
presumably, I don't see why it wouldn't have, correct?
Well, we should know, right? I mean, don't we know whether...
I'm telling you that this is probably This is orange brick pipe, which is a clay pipe.
Yeah.
And it could be 150 years old, I don't know. It's certainly more than 75 years old.
But this problem isn't 75 years old, right?
I wouldn't say so, no. Because I don't think that sediment has been there that long.
Okay. What I'm trying to get at is that the town's responsibility or part of the, this situation seems to be not the problem. It seems like the culvert under the road is big enough to handle the flow from lots 36 and 38 and whatever the drainage area is that it was originally put down for. And then what happens is if landowners change the land or their use of the land so that the drainage pattern changes, whether it increases or decreases, then that's a problem caused by the landowners, not the town. And so the town shouldn't be held responsible for that if it's not the town's fault. If the town did something to restrict the flow, then I'd say we have a responsibility to repair it. But if we haven't done anything to restrict the flow and the flow is being restricted due to sedimentation on the landowner's land, then the landowners, where the sedimentation is occurring, should get rid of the sedimentation. Right? I mean, that seems fair.
Absolutely.
Mr. Ferrick, would you agree?
I still maintain that I would like to see the town take more of a interest in it and do whatever they can because they have the equipment.
Well, we're interested in doing whatever we can to rectify any problems that may have occurred because of anything that the town did. But if the landowner hasn't kept their ditches clean, I don't believe the town should take responsibility for that. I think the landowner has to clean their ditches.
No, it sounds like Mr. Barshinsky said that he does that on the south side, and the problem, from what I'm hearing, is
well, it doesn't sound like
on the north side.
No,
right,
the problem's on
the
north
restriction.
Side.
So right. I think somebody got to determine where that restriction is actually in place.
Well, I would like to see the two landowners, 34 and 37, do what they can to remove the sediment, and then if there's still a problem, and by then we can look, Keith, right at the outlet to make sure that that's all right. That's our responsibility. And if there's any problems there, we'll fix it. And if the landowners get rid of the sediment as needed and we fix whatever we need to fix, there shouldn't be a problem. And if there is a problem, then we have to deal with that. But it doesn't seem fair that the town should do something if it's not causing the problem. And certainly Mr. Barshinsky seems to be suffering from the backup that he's not causing. At least that's what I'm hearing. Yeah?
I guess my question is, you had mentioned a big renovation. Has this been exacerbated since the renovation?
What renovation?
Mr. Barshinsky's renovation.
No. No, it hasn't been exacerbated because of it and everything. Like I say, whenever we get a torrential rain, be it in middle of summer, be it in the middle of winter, okay, water backs up on the south side of Christian Lane. It backs up all the way to 33-1. That's how far the water backs up, okay? It completely inundates my backyard. My backyard is completely full of water.
Now, the only reason I could see for you having any responsibility is if you did some landscaping or construction that would have deposited a lot of silt that then went under the road and then accumulated on the other properties.
No, nothing happens. Like you say, whenever the water backs up, it's taking all the dirt and everything off of the fields, all the way back to probably 24, 26, and 31.
Well, here's a suggestion. Fred, you can chime in. So you're suffering a cost due to the backup.
Correct.
And Mr. Farrick, you're faced with a possible cost to get rid of the sediment if that's the way things go. However, what I'm hearing from Keith is the cost is not going to be very great, and it would be a matter of having a backhoe in there for an hour or so getting rid of the sediment. And so you guys are neighbors. You could just split the cost if you wanted, and that way everybody would be happy. You get the drainage and you get your sediment out of there, and the town would be held harmless. And you know, we're talking an hour of backhoe, maybe $240.
Yeah, the only thing that I also, and I don't have an answer to, is it should probably be run in front of the Conservation Commission. I don't know if they would justify any of that wetland.
But if you split the cost, that wouldn't be very much, and then you'd both be better off for it. Otherwise, if you guys can't agree, then you know, then what are you going to do? Take it a small claims
to
court?
Help out at all either.
Then you could split it three ways. I mean, it seems to me, yes, Wasilewski ought to help too. So you're reducing the cost to everybody. And then it's much less, right? I mean, we're talking not even hundreds of dollars a piece. We're talking tens, you know. I know it's annoying.
Well, why can't the town absorb the cost?
It's not the town didn't cause the problem. Evidently. I mean, from what I'm hearing. Yeah.
I don't understand. You were talking about a reduction of the pipe size. Who would have done that? Where did that come from? That wasn't the town? I mean,
that was not the town.
Where did that all happen or come
from? The smaller pipe?
Yes.
Must have come from the landowner. It's not in town property.
Yeah, we like to help out landowners as much as we can if it's related to town property or caused by some action the town has done. But here we don't see what's on town property being the cause of this problem. So we can't go on private property to fix issues that aren't related to the town. I mean, that could happen anywhere else in town once we start with helping private property owners fix a drainage problem.
How far does the town own from the center of the road?
The 25 feet, roughly, from the center of the road. So that's the line you see on this map is the right town right away.
Correct.
Who won? Oh, that bad.
Must be a coach.
I guess kind of not directly, well, indirectly related to this is, Keith, is there a need to replace that pipe that's under the road?
No. It's in excellent condition.
Okay, so that, okay.
We definitely know that.
So where's Wasilewski? Where are they? Where he or she or them?
Well, again, all I can tell you is we don't know, because we don't know where that property line is. We don't know whether...
Don't we see it right here?
Well, in the field, I can't tell you exactly where that property line is. It may be that there is nothing that needs to be cleaned out on the Wasilewski property. Okay. It's hard to tell. I don't know other than I just sketched it, basically a rough sketch in there as to where it goes.
You haven't found any property stones, markers?
Not that property line, unless you bring a surveyor in and...
Yeah. Well, I mean, let's start... Mr. Farrick, why don't we just start... Why don't you just start getting rid of some of that sediment? And, if it seems to go in and have your neighbor there, Wasilewski, help pay for it as well, and maybe Mr. Barshensky would throw in something as well, and
If we could split it three ways, that's fine by me. Like I say, I just want to stop the problem.
Right. And if it's an hour with a backhoe, it's not going to be that expensive.
It's going to take more time for, you know, somebody to mobilize and provide it. The only issue, as I said, that might make it more expensive if conservation says it needs, you know, be permitted. If they would say, just go ahead and clean it out, right now it's dry.
So you'd have to...
I would assume that it could be cleaned without... It could be considered a fern ditch, but I can't answer for the conservation.
But Mr. Farron could have somebody, a friend or whatever, with a backhoe or something, come and dig it out, right?
Well, I have the... Dave Jackson is still... He's a tenant, so that I think there is some responsibility of his there as being a tenant. And yeah, I believe it could be worked out. Right?
Okay, well, why don't we work it out and then see what happens? I mean, you know, I think that's I think that's the cheapest way to go, which you all, you know, don't want to bear a big cost. And I don't think anybody have to bear a big cost, and you might split it three ways or whatever and be even cheaper. And then if in the process we see that the town, there's some problem with the town's culvert or whatever, we'll take care of it. The town will take care of that. Yeah. I think that's the way to go. And everybody's happy and nobody's paying for the whole thing. And
yeah. Well, Keith, would there be, if you're talking about three ways, does that mean that after the work is done and you have the cost, then you're going to send individual statements to each landowner?
No, I'm suggesting that the landowners find someone to do it.
I see. Okay.
So does it need to go in front of the conservation or not?
We can't determine that. I can't determine.
Who does?
I mean,
the conservation committee.
Okay.
I could certainly facilitate the conversation with the chairman of the conservation and get his opinion.
Did they get involved with that other ditch that was turned down on Cocats?
I don't know. See, that's if they don't get involved in that, then this is by no means an issue.
Right. There's some provision for agricultural.
It probably would be considered to be covered under agriculture, but I'm just I have to cover my bases before I go and do things.
So the landowners should check with conservation.
I don't mind facilitating.
You'll facilitate. Okay, so Keith will help you all with the Conservation Commission and see if you even need to go in front of them to get permission or whatever. If not, then you can repair it as needed.
Yeah, it sounds reasonable.
Okay. Are you okay with this, Mr. Barshansky?
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Yeah.
Great.
I just want the problem fixed.
I get it. Well, it doesn't sound like it's a big problem in the scheme of things. Great scheme of things. Okay. We're good. All right. Well, thank you for coming in. And good luck. John, I'll turn it over to you, Mr. Chair.
This is a select board meeting, right?
Yes, it is.
Okay. I need to know where I am. And I apologize for being late, but...
Apology accepted.
Apparently this meeting started at 6.
Yes, it did. On the request of one of our members.
Probably me.
Yes.
Good. Welcome to my life these days.
Okay.
All right. Keith, you're still up.
Chapter 90. I have some more Chapter 90 project requests. These are for chip sealing on Westbrook Road, chip sealing on Swamp Road, blacktop work that I had mentioned before, on Christian Lane, and also on Long Plain Road, which would be from the intersection of Sandy Lane back to roughly where the Pelock residence was, where that joint is from a year ago. This is all within the realms of what we have available for Chapter 90 money for this fiscal year.
Well, you just paved Swamp Road while you were chip sealing.
Swamp Road, all we did was do a level, just a leveling cup. We didn't do a level and overlay. It was just that the Swamp Road was so out of shape and so bad in ruts and things like that. It needed more than just to be chip sealed.
I thought it was wonderful.
So
it didn't go faster now.
Correct.
It's always a problem.
But because it was just a skim coat and the place where it's dragging, the road's already got cracks in it. It was, what we put down is not substantial to, it needs to be sealed over.
Do we need to sign anything?
Yes, those need to be signed.
So is that what's going to happen here, Long Plain Road?
Long Plain, this section of Long Plain would be chip sealed in the next following year.
Do we sign up here where it's
No, okay. Down in the right.
The right? Right, oh, municipal office.
Yeah, they only, someone's going to have to sign below that. They only allow.
Is it everybody or? I don't suppose that replacing curbing is part of that chip sealing on Swamp Road.
We've got to address that. We've got to fix that up.
Again, if you feel like, you know, leveling that out, knock yourself out.
Again, being on that hill, if we don't protect the edge, then the water runs, washes the edge of it.
Right.
That's what the berm is there for.
Yeah. Yep. Because it's all going to be gone eventually, that curbing. As you know, I don't have to point that out to you, obviously.
You know, we still are retaining at the my Chapter 90 project for Egypt Road is still open. However, the way things are going land-wise, I hate to say this, but I'm feeling like it will be virtually impossible to have anything done here this year. I don't know if Mark has any more to offer on that other than it's become a nightmare with the land, and I actually, one thing I'll throw out there that we may be better off just taking it by eminent domain.
The land?
You mean on the corner, you mean where the top pump is?
Yep. I don't know what Mark's thoughts are on that, there's probate issues.
Which can be years.
I don't know.
Well, probate issues, by definition.
I can't answer that. There's a sibling, you know, in the just basic things that have happened is the land that the person who's the name of the landowner is deceased, and since he deceased, he's had a sibling. I mean, one of his children is deceased, and there's no wills involved in any of these people. Am I saying that correctly?
Yeah, that's exactly the situation. So it's been every time we think we're take one step forward, we end up taking two back. So
where would the money, if we took it by eminent domain, there's obviously money involved, compensatory.
I don't know
where
how that works.
We would pay fair
market value.
To who, though?
For it. I don't
that's
know.
That's unclear.
Right, well, that's like, so I guess my point is if you take it by eminent domain,
who
are you taking it from?
I don't know if the town has the right to take it and then let the courts or let the legal aspect of that worry about that later. I don't know. I mean, that's another.
What if the town takes it and nobody complains? We're okay.
There's still
just
a deed.
Move the pole.
That way we'll find out whose land it is. Somebody will say, hey, you took my land.
Still a deed for the property, and the town sends a tax bill to the deed owner.
And she pays the bill.
Yeah, if somebody pays the bill, so we would do the same thing. So you would do the same thing with this.
His wife pays the bill. The land is in his name. He died in 1998.
And she's been agreeable to all this.
She's.
But there's no will. So only half goes to the wife. The rest goes to the siblings. And then one of the siblings died. So now that quarter goes to the next.
You've got to check to see where that sibling's heir. You know.
Right. Well, and that. So that may be right. Maybe we just do it, and then the estate. The estate courts can figure out where the money goes.
I
skipped those classes in law school. Mostly it's because I skipped law school.
I think that might be a question that we ask
our counsel
at this point.
Okay.
But again, it's frustrating because I thought, I mean, my God, it's been almost a year.
Yeah, we thought this was going to be a simple.
We've been trying to just buy a $2,500 piece of property for over a year.
Any How are things for Williamsburg Road?
And again, we got to get a, that's one of the things that Mark and I are working on. We've got to get a letter to Mass DOT to push them some more.
I have an update on that, actually.
Oh, you do?
Yeah.
On Williamsburg Road? Or on Haydenville Road?
No, sorry, Haydenville Road.
Okay, I was going to say, I didn't think of it.
No, that's right. You and I are going to get together to draft the letter for it.
This is now working on 3 years.
I
know. Oh, I'm not blaming you, Keith. I'm just, what do we do? It's not going anywhere.
So frustrating. Mass DOT, you know, they, when we, my engineer sends something to them, it's probably 6 months before I can get a response back out of them. It's horrible, but I think we need to another, we have a new director in District 2. Al Stegman was the last one. He's moved on, and now we have a new director, and I think we need to get a letter to him and try to stir it up.
So be it. Let's get a letter to him. Stir it up.
What's his name?
The new director?
Yeah.
Pat Paul. Patrick Paul.
Now, Keith, is it possible to put on our, maybe I should ask Mark, Mary Ellen, on our website, the roads that you're going to be paving this summer, so I guess people would know. I bet some people have asked me, well, when are you doing this? When are you doing it? So we avoid that road as much as possible, or even farmers driving up and down Christian Lane if you're going to be out there paving.
Right, well, the thing that I certainly can do something maybe like the week of type thing. I'm at the mercy of the weather. Yeah. I don't want, it's very difficult, especially if someone does like what I call the robocalls. We've done things like that in the past,
right,
where the message has gone out for paving. I'd rather leave it the week of type of thing, because if you set a specific date and then you don't do it that day, and sometimes it's, you know, it's just a matter of being in the pecking order of where you go, and we get bumped a couple days, then if we don't do it on the day we say we're going to do it, sometimes people get upset because they say, well, you told me you were going to do it on Monday and you didn't do it till Wednesday.
Yeah. I always don't get that, but maybe for the ones where you do want to know, it would be helpful.
I certainly will give that information to the, to like Lynn, the town clerk, or someone here to see what we can do to certainly get on the website and or get a robo. Because a lot of times we've done it before, and if we can time it with maybe like, for instance, if tax bills are due August 1st or something like that, and if we're in that time frame, we'll include it at the same time on a robo call.
But at the same time, you don't want to pay this on August 1st, though, necessarily. But
yeah, I'm just saying that if we can time it to a...
Okay. What other updates?
I think those are the main things that I wanted to... there's a lot of loose ends, you know, that I need to work, try to tie up with Mark in his time here.
Mark, why don't you then... What do you got for Haydenville Road since Keith's here?
Did you get that update from... Were you on that email?
The only thing that I got was you told me that the meeting was going to be in sometime in June and you weren't going to be here.
Okay. Yeah, so basically we received an email from Paul Dunphy. We had tried to schedule the three towns, or two towns in a city, tried to schedule a meeting of all the interested parties. I did receive an email from Paul Dunphy in response to our letter. He was advising us that the funds for this project, Haydenville Road, were not included in the Mass DOT capital improvement plan for 2017 to 2021. Mm. However, Representative Kulik has invited us to discuss all the parties to get together again to continue the conversation about how we can advocate for funding, at least for the engineering portion of this, so that once funds are made available for this project, it's shovel ready. We're at least making some progress.
And there would be TIP funds, right? Eventually.
Yes. The construction would be
TIP. Yeah, the construction, right.
The date right now is June 17th in Williamsburg. I don't have a time yet.
At what time? Oh, you're not in town, sorry.
No, there's so many parties involved between the two districts and the three communities and Rosenberg's office, Kulik's office, Downing's office. All we have right now is the 17th, and it would be great if somebody could represent, whether it's you or somebody from the select board.
I'm sure I could be there. It'd be real nice if we can have someone from...
I might be able to be there, just find out what time it is in advance as possible.
Yeah, as soon as I know a time, I'll shoot it out to all of you, so. There's an email chain, Jonathan, that I copied you on in response to this because I knew you'd be interested in this conversation, so.
Yeah, okay. All right. Good. Thanks, Keith. Mr. Smith and Mr. Antaya.
Good evening.
How are you, gentlemen?
Good, you sir?
Good, thank you.
Coach?
Sort of, these days. Sort of everything and sort of nothing these days. All right. Why don't you take this, Mark?
Okay, so we invited Richard and Paul in tonight to talk about, I guess just to initiate a conversation about how we improve the budget process for the coming year, improve communication. I'll give you an example. When it came to signing the warrant, there were several questions about the budget that had been addressed in the capital planning meetings, the personnel meetings, the finance meetings, but then they come up again during the selectmen's meeting. So that would be my first recommendation, would be to talk about how we can maybe hold joint meetings in the coming year, and also about just improving the overall budget process for everyone involved. It seemed like a really,
It seems to be a lot of redundancy in regards to what the town administrator has to go through. And I know the finance committee would like to position the calendar so that we have more time between town meeting and when you have all your numbers together.
You mean the other way around? When we have our numbers, when we have a budget proposal to town meeting?
Right.
When we start after town meeting?
In other words, have a full budget together to be able to look at the budget in total, how that impacts the tax rate, and whether or not we have to challenge any of those dollars that are in there or not. Because you need to work from a number, and you need to work one way or the other from that number that comes out of the process. And right now, that's kind of tough to do because everything is so sped up at the end of, March and April, and it's so compacted. So we'd like to at least talk about that calendar issue and see if we can do something with that. But
are there any other towns that do have a calendar any different than we?
No, some towns start their budget season before New Year's. You're looking at very preliminary estimated numbers at that point. So, the budget doesn't really start to firm up until the beginning of February. And that's what is, that's just the reality in every community.
I guess I have a concern of where does the select board fit into this whole process? I wasn't involved in many of them budget meetings with either finance or personnel. And then it comes to seeing the warrant article and I have questions and it's like, what are you doing asking these questions? Six other committees already approved it. Well, when did the select board have a chance to review that before it got approved by these other committees? Who's in charge of deciding what projects get funded?
What is the role of the finance board? What's the role of the select board in this whole process? Maybe it should be the reverse. Maybe the select board should prioritize projects that we think should go forward, and then finance committee decide how much money we have to fund them, rather than them deciding what funds are available for each project.
Well, you have a representative on the personnel committee and a representative on capital committee, and you know, those committees are making recommendations to the finance committee, and I think that that process works okay. But where I personally think the miscommunication is starting, or lack of communication, I guess, is that if I had my way, I would like to see the budget meetings between the finance committee and the select board be joint meetings. You know, you still want to have the personnel committee and the capital committee do their work and make recommendations. I don't think you want to be involved in every step of it, but once it gets to that next stage where you know, because after those two meetings conclude, I put together a draft budget and present it to the finance committee, and that's the point where I think the select board should be getting involved in. And that's the point where I think the joint meetings would be really beneficial.
I think the joint meetings are crucial. And I think that they need to, so that no one feels like they're always having an extra meeting, that we find a balance between when the meeting is at a regularly scheduled select board meeting and when it is a regularly scheduled finance committee meeting, because we all have plenty of meetings to go to. And it will mean a few extra meetings for some people, perhaps, but the burden shouldn't be on one board over another board. So I think it's a good idea. I think part of Fred's frustration, and Fred, correct me if I'm not clarifying your statement, is that the finance committee and the select board really need to figure out how to best work the process together in a more communicative way and defining of roles. You know, the finance committee has the oversight over how much money the town has to spend, and the select board has the responsibility of setting town policies and priorities. And the way it's worked in some people's eyes over the past few years is that the role of setting policy and priorities for the town has sort of transitioned to, well, can we afford it or not? And in some people's eyes, the role of the finance committee would be to say, okay, this is what the town can afford. You guys spend it how you feel appropriate, but this is what we recommend is the ceiling on that expense. And then if the select board chooses that, well, we need more money, override or not fund as much, but the policy needs to be set and the direction for the town needs to be set here. And the finance committee says, that might be tough to afford, just keep that in mind. And then you can move those rocks around.
Well, I think it's clearly that the affordability aspect
is one that the finance committee feels we're the only ones looking at that. And
that's subjective, of course.
It is. But we really haven't had a lot of pushback on that either. And someone has to do that. Now going back a few years, I can remember select board meetings, finance committee meetings, when Harold Swift was the chairperson of the finance committee, we would meet with select board on pretty much a regular basis. Charlie Olenek and AI and...
You're talking 20 years.
Yeah. But back then, I'll tell you, I bet Harold was at every select board meeting talking about, you know, where the FinCom was, and he would often invite other FinCom members to go with him. And I went a few times. You know, I think that was effective to a point. But anyway, it's certainly made for communication.
So how many meetings are we talking? Joint meetings, because I like the idea of joint meetings. I think that...
Probably four.
During budget season.
During budget season.
I think we are...
You know, we actually could... I mean, if this is as important as I think it is, adding an extra meeting based upon everyone... Now, you're never going to find a date that's convenient for everybody, obviously. But, you know, budget season and a proper budget shouldn't be restricted to, well, we couldn't come to an agreement because we only had four meetings to agree. Well, no, and then you add another meeting. And that's how you get things accomplished, is you put the time in necessary to figure it out. And I just don't want to be restricted by, well, the meeting schedule is the meeting schedule. We set the meeting schedule how we feel it should be set to accomplish what our needs are.
Now, there may be an opportunity in the fall
to kick this joint meeting process off. And that's when we sit down with the, Mark, help me out here. We're sitting down with the Enterprise Fund.
Oh, okay.
To discuss payback to the town, if it's viable, what it looks like. But I think that's a meeting that Select Board and Finance Committee should be together on.
It might be worth having a meeting preliminary to any actual meeting where you have to get down in the reeds, mm-hmm. to articulate the kind of policy and, you know, things that you were talking about, Jonathan, where you can communicate among yourselves that the Select Board and the departments that report to it, the thrust for fiscal 2018 looks like this. We expect this kind of infrastructure need, this kind of whatever need at this point. And then after that, I think these guys would have a better understanding of sort of the parameters from a, you know, task perspective that they need to look at from a financial point of view. And then enterprise fund meetings or joint meetings that summarize 2 weeks worth of hearings that they've held on finance or whatever, so that you understand how your goals and the town's goals that are articulated through you are going to be financed for a given year.
Sounds reasonable to me.
Yeah, I fully agree with what you were saying, John, about your interpretation of what I was trying to say. And I think that's the way we should be moving and for the next fiscal year, for both the finance and the Select Board, the way we should be getting involved, making decisions. And one other thing that I think may help, I don't know if you call it make it more civil or more on target for these meetings, is to have them all broadcast on FCAT. Let's publicize each one of these finance committee meetings, finance and even personnel committees.
Well, at some point, we're going to have video capability. Well,
and everything will be broadcast.
Yeah, I know, but for next year, I mean, I guess I would like to see that happen.
I think it needs to. I think just in terms of transparency across the town.
Yeah. I mean, probably half our meetings are
taped. And I'm not sure why the other half are not, but they are at this point.
I got to believe that we're going to be, what would be your guess? When are we going to be just having anyone who comes in here to make a phone call is going to be taped? I mean, soon.
We have money in the Peg Access Capital account.
Right, and we've been waiting for the whole, but that's moving forward now.
I'm waiting on Comcast.
Right? Waiting on Comcast.
So that could be a death sentence.
They've got to run the drop in.
Okay, so what's holding that up?
The contract.
Between us and Comcast?
Between all three towns. All three towns.
And Comcast, right? So.
Well, yes, I think you're right. And we need to have these things broadcast
But we also need to, the temperature needs to be brought down a little bit.
Paul and I had an extended discussion about procedural things within the Finance Committee and perhaps tighter meeting control and so forth. So I think we'll be okay.
That's good to hear. Because I've been hearing a lot of it.
The broadcasting will maybe control some of that too.
Well, and also
something like being watched.
Well, yeah, than being watched.
Also, if we have joint meetings, then if there's a food fight, it's going to involve everybody, and it'll be more interesting viewing for one thing.
Right.
You know, our ratings will go up.
I will. If our ratings go up, we get advertisers.
There you go.
Actually, what would be nice if we actually came here to the meeting as opposed to just watching on television. But
that would be nice, because we don't want people getting up at town meeting saying things that reflect a lack of engagement with the process to that point. Not anybody here, but I'm just saying there were some people making noises at town meeting, and I thought, why didn't you come to any meetings?
I know, but you know, we keep trying. But Paul, I gotta say that I think it's unfortunate if the members of the Finance Committee feel that they're the only ones in town with any authority, to use lack of any other word, that have their eye on the financial state of the town. I guess those comments, and clearly if you said it here, it's said in Finance Committee meetings. And I guess those kinds of comments just aren't productive, because it's essentially saying that none of the three of us care about the fiscal state of the town or have our eye on the fiscal state of the town. And none of the department heads have a sense of their independent department, their individual department budgets. And we all work really hard for this town. Now, we all may have different lenses, and we may all have different feelings about what is fiscally responsible and what is not fiscally responsible. But I think all of us care an awful lot about making sure this town is in good shape today and is in good shape in 10 years, 20 years.
I absolutely agree with you that anybody involved to this level cares about what happens to this town. My point was that I don't believe when decisions are made in any department to move forward with spending, that they understand the impact to the tax rate, that they impact the impact to the taxpayer, the average household in town. What are they going to pay when we have to put a new fire truck on, a new dump truck on, when we have to redo a building? What is the number? That number only comes as a result of when the process is through and we look at it and you do the math, then that number comes out. But that number is not in the process of all these little departments over time. It's just not. Okay. We need it. We need those things. Keith needs a truck. He can't send the guys out on a truck that's going to break down. We need a new fire truck. We get that. And those are all, and we recommended them all. But we know, even the Capital Improvement Committee, when they want something for a building, we know darn well that how could you understand what the impact of this is going to be until the end of the process? Not that people don't care. People care deeply. And they care with their time and their energy and their love for the town. But the number, the actual number, is not going to rise up. It's not going to bubble up until the process is through.
And that's what I meant by that. And that's how we kind of feel.
Well, I think I haven't sat on the capital plan committee now for, what, 5 years?
All you've been on it? It's been a while.
It's been a while.
Yeah.
But I remember when I was on it for at least half of the 12 years that I've been a select board member, we did talk about whether it was something that the town, what was going to, what its impact on the town was going to be. I mean, that was a conversation.
And I mean, it's a gut feeling.
But I will add that I know that the finance committee has said on capital planning, our job is to prioritize what the policy is. Other people have to decide whether we can afford it. Well, then, but what you're saying is perhaps the capital planning committee should also have a closer look on whether it's affordable. But the capital planning committee or Keith, they don't have the whole package.
They don't.
Exactly. We do. He does. And whoever's after him does. And you guys do.
Mm-hmm. We do know what free cash is going into the capital process.
We do.
And that's generally how you have funded capital purchases in the past. So there is some indication early on how we, you know, how we stand financially as we discuss the capital plan.
You know, if you think of your own homes, your own pocketbooks,
you want to make a purchase, you go look in the bank.
I ask my wife usually.
And we ask our wives, is the money there? Then we process it from that point, from that number out. In towns throughout the Commonwealth, it's the other way around. It's the, you don't look at the impact to the taxpayer. Instead, what we do is we say, we need this, we need this, we need this. And yeah, we do need those things. If the money's not there, we'll adjust the tax rate. Well, I think people are just tired of that. And I just think that's, and the finance committee feels that that's not the ideal way to go about it.
My challenge is, and I get it, but my challenge is that we need to make sure that the finance committee, you know, when you talk to people running for office, and they say, I don't talk to one person who doesn't believe in X. And you know what? They're telling the truth because they don't talk to anyone else That's besides right. those people who say that. Right. It's not like there are not other people out there who don't agree.
That's an excellent point. And it's really the
sort of the stepping stone to how the Finance Committee looks at the town population. You know, we have the committee people, us, committees. You've got the meeting goers, people that show up at the meetings. You've got the voters. And then you've got the taxpayers. Okay. Finance committee, we think about the taxpayer. And I think a lot of other people do, and I'm not trying to say we're the only ones that do that. But they're the primary focus for the FinCom. The tax. We think the town is the taxpayer. The town is not the meeting goers, just the meeting goers, not just the voters, not just the people on the committees. It's an apolitical process, and we think that's important.
I agree, and again, I like this conversation actually because it's a conversation that doesn't take place. But I guess I would argue that. Seven or nine people in finance?
Seven.
How many people are in town? How many voters? How many residents? How many, not households, how many residents are in town?
1996.
You know, I'm not sure any body of seven people can have a true finger on the pulse of a number that's exponentially by many larger than that seven person population.
Which is exactly why we're so focused
with the tax rate. Because I can guarantee you, there's 1,492 people in town. Of those paying taxes, 90% are going to be very, very acutely aware, concerned about what their tax rate is.
They all will. It doesn't necessarily mean that they don't want to spend more money. They're acutely aware.
And, right.
You know, we can, and
it, I feel like the Finance Committee has a very valuable role to play. The role to play, as I see it, is you hear from capital planning, you hear from the select board, you hear from personnel, you hear the expressed needs of the town. You hear from elected officials, us, that we're saying the town needs this, the town needs that. And it seems to me your job is then to say back to us before we get the town meeting, and maybe that's what these joint committees will produce, is an understanding of, well, you guys say you want this, that, and this. This is the implications financially. That means you might have to go for an override, or you might have to raise the tax rate. That's a political decision. That's not a Finance Committee decision. Your job is to tell us, this is what you're talking about in terms of how much money we collect in taxes and how much we can spend. If you want to spend more than that, you can spend more than that. You can go in debt. A lot of people spend more money in their, if you talk about households, a lot of people have credit card debt. A lot of people have mortgages. They can't afford to buy a house.
Sure.
So they take out a loan.
Sure.
We all do that. The town has to do that for big expenditures. That's not irresponsible fiscally. That's providing people with what they need and what they want. Now, your job is to say, if you want that, here's the kind of effect it's going to have on the tax rate, and here's what the interest payments are going to mean down the road. And, you know, we're just saying, do you really want to go this route? And we need that. As you said, you're the watchdog. The watchdog tells us what the implications are for the tax.
And that's, I think, what we've kind of been doing at certain on town floor.
If there's an article, you know, specifically highlighting what the impact to the average tax rate would be, and you know, I think that conversation is bubbling up more and more because of how the Finance Committee has been guiding itself with Mark over the past 2 years.
But has anybody ever come back and said, okay, the bottom number is the budget, how much increase you're going from 1 year to another, and of course, the tax rate. Has anybody, whether it's a select board, or come back and say, well, we don't want to increase the town budget, so what can we cut out of projects the Finance Committee is recommending? Has anybody done it that way? And, you know, some of these projects, you could do that. You could delay buying a vehicle for a year, and which would balance the budget. You wouldn't have any increase, no tax implications.
Absolutely.
But if we looked at that, has this town looked at it that way, or do we just approve everything because money is there and it's only 0.68% increase, so that's a small amount, everybody can afford it?
John?
Well, yes and yes.
Yeah.
Just to follow up on Paul's comment about the taxpayer being concerned about that, a point of information, and you probably realize with our development, in fact, my wife was there weeding the rain gardens along the road today, and this couple drove by and stopped. Their first question was, how are the taxes here? So we've heard that a lot, you know, over the past few years when we've been developing the land out there. People from the outside coming in are looking at that also.
Sure. Yeah, well, they'll also ask how are the schools, and they'll, you know.
Right.
My point, I think, is that the Finance Committee is not a decision-making committee. The Select Board's elected to make decisions. The Finance Committee is to inform the impacts of certain decisions that we'll have on the tax base. And it's up to the voters to decide. There is no taxpayers. Everybody's a taxpayer. But the people who decide what we're ultimately going to spend with our advice and consent, with their consent, are the people who show up and vote, yes or no, ultimately at town meeting or at an election for an override. It's not up to the Finance Committee to say, we shouldn't do that. It's up to the Finance Committee to say, if you do that, here's what the impact's going to be on the taxes. And then it's up to the voter to say, I like that or I don't like it.
It's up, the job of the finance committee is to put the budget together.
Okay. And present the budget to the town and make a recommendation on that budget to the town. That's,
I disagree.
That's state law.
Okay. I think it's up to the town to decide what to do. It's up to the finance committee to tell the town the implications and impacts of your budget. If you do this,
sure.
You know, it may be semantics we're dealing with here.
It could be.
But I think the tone has been such that people have felt that the finance committee has been a little heavy-handed. Now, some people probably think otherwise. I'm sure they do. But I think we could dispel, we could get on a clearer footing if we met together as we've talked about.
And I think we're on the same
before. So I think we have a good game plan for the next fiscal year. And we should execute it in a way that's
And we should start earlier.
We should start early.
In terms of what the priority, and have a comment, you know, we need to start talking about what are our priorities, you know, and I don't know whether there are certain things in the budget process that can be expedited. Not everything, but capital items. Could that be moved up a bit? Perhaps, I don't know, it's funny how the capital items work. You remember 2 years ago, and I admit it, I chuckled. We had a $400,000 fire truck on our town meeting floor. And we had a $7,000 line item for sharing of a
shovel,
grader,
bucket truck.
The fire truck got 0 seconds of debate. $400,000, which by the way, the last time I checked is a lot of money. And the bucket truck share had probably a 20-minute debate, and it was $7,000. So it does go beyond the bottom line, because that $400,000 is certainly going to impact the bottom line more than $7,000.
Right.
But it was a policy discussion. It was a political, is this a direction that we want to take?
Not only that, but I think in that case,
fire truck is safety. And I think a lot of people just say,
sure,
I want the fire put out at my house.
When we did the ambulance, our budget increased, but it was safety. So yeah, but that's public policy. That's political debate.
That's not a tax rate. That's,
we also had a similar debate on longevity, which was a very small budget item.
Small, tiny.
Well, it was what, $1,500?
Yeah.
Nothing, but no. $1,500 that created a firestorm of concern on the town employees, and there were a lot of people who were upset about the finance committee's take on longevity. I'm not saying whether it's right or wrong, but I think the finance committee should have just said, if you do this, here's what's gonna happen. And that's it.
The finance committee
did not. We didn't back that longevity raise. It had nothing to do with the dollar amount. It had everything to do with the process. And we didn't feel that we could recommend to the town that the town support a payment that came from a process that we had no control over. It came from a union negotiated contract with Whately Elementary School, that Whately Elementary decided out of the goodness of their heart to include non-union people in that pay raise.
Right.
And so now that whole process came to the town, and we felt that let them have the money, but it's the way it was done that was, and now the press, now the die's been cast. And so the town is opened up to more of that in the future.
Right, but that fault is a policy decision. It's not a financial decision. And the finance committee.
Now the finance committee is his, you know, you can say that it's just dollars and cents.
But in many, many ways, the finance committee also looks at these dollar amounts from a value perspective. Does it make sense for the town? Is there something that is awry here that the town is not going to have the benefit from this expenditure that it appears to have up front. So those type of things, that whole value issue is extremely important.
And you don't think that's the job of the select board?
As well.
Then I would argue, you could make an argument, that the finance committee should be an elected body.
Absolutely.
As opposed to appointed by one person. And I'm not picking on Richard. I'm picking on, because Richard hasn't appointed anybody.
Well, that's not true. Yeah.
You have, on the finance, I apologize. That one went, but a lot these days does. But my point is that it's appointed by one, maybe it should be an elected body.
But if you do that, it now becomes a political entity in town.
Sure.
Which is why half the reason that we don't do it. And if we did do it, we'd have to pay them.
Or maybe it should be appointed by a cross-section of the town. Some appointed by moderator, some appointed by select board, some appointed some other way.
So it's going to reflect.
Keep apolitical. I think you've got to keep politics out of it.
Well, and that's what it would be doing, because you would have a cross-representation of the entire town. These two finance committees members are appointed by X. I mean, it's sort of like the SEC in the federal government. Some are appointed by Congress, some are appointed by the, you know.
Paul, when you're talking about values, which I agree are important, the contest of values in a political world is the arena of politics. And the arena of politics should be the elected representatives of the people should be deciding how to place value on certain things. I don't think the finance committee should be assigning values to things except monetary.
No, you said values.
You said values.
Well, I think you're using it out of context.
I'm not using values as a monetary term. I'm using it as a political term. Maybe you're using it as a monetary term. Which you should, because you're on the finance committee.
Yeah.
But as far as values go, like, what does this mean to the town employees to have longevity pay? That's a normative question. It's a question of values. How much do we value the town employees? And should we go with this, even though, you know, the school did it, but the school did it. We can't stop the school from doing it now unless we get into a political fight. Which people want to do, but that's a political thing. It's not for the finance committee should just say, if you do this, it's going to cost you this much, and this is what the budget. It's going to affect the budget like this. Not say you shouldn't do it. Should is a value term. You should say, and I'm using values here because this is what we're about here. You should say, this is how it's going to impact your budget. You decide if you want to do that, but this is how it's going to affect the budget. And I think for the finance committee to say not recommend or recommend is kind of a problematic thing. I know what it's for, but it tends to seep into the value aspect as opposed to the budgetary aspect.
Well, that's, I think it was intended
exactly that way.
They're called upon by state law to make a recommendation.
Okay.
All right, so right. It isn't that this group of people or the 300 people that have served before them have somehow stepped out of their bounds in recommending or not recommending.
Right.
I hope everyone understands that.
Right, so, okay. Right. Oh, I couldn't agree more. I mean, the recommendation. But maybe
we need to do a better job educating the, and we're getting, and I don't want to continue this for a long time tonight, but maybe we need to do a better job talking about the perspective that we're coming from when individual organizations are making that recommendation or not a recommendation, so that the public knows this is their lens. You know, because again, elected bodies make their value judgment, and they are at the mercy of the voter. Thumbs up, thumbs down. So it's an easy one. Appointed bodies don't have that check and balance.
virtually every town in the state of Massachusetts.
The moderator appoints the finance committee. Virtually every town, open town meeting form of government town.
And
this isn't an anomaly. This is the way it is mostly done.
And it's set up that way for a number of reasons. But one of those reasons is a check and balance against a political system. Because that doesn't exist in small towns like it does at the federal level. You know, you got checks and balance, House representative, you got the executive, that doesn't happen here.
I think the long and short of this is that we're going to be able to work together much more constructively with joint sessions.
I agree.
And so there won't be a delay in hearsay about, you hear what they did or hear what they did, and, we'll be together. Right. And we'll be able to work these issues out together. So I think that's the best we can do, and we should plan for that as soon as possible.
Okay. Let's have an open joint meeting to discuss the process.
Yeah.
Maybe we meet every month. I mean, seriously.
The finance committee was talking about that some time ago,
about, getting together much sooner than the budget process.
Could you do that in the context of one of your meetings?
Sure.
I mean, Keith is here, for a half an hour every,
once every three meetings.
Well, okay, so once every three or four meetings.
Mm-hmm. We ask the police chief to come in.
8 to 8:45 or whatever is the joint meeting with the finance committee.
Couldn't agree more. And I'm happy to sometimes go to the finance committee meeting when, again, to not make you guys always the one who have to add another meeting to your schedule. That should be a shared sacrifice.
We're going to push for one mandate, though, on
the meeting process. We all get name tags.
You can have name tags, but I don't know about the gold, That's an expense that the voter, the taxpayer,
You know what?
We used to have
tags, so no one can have a name tag.
Oh, okay. That's fine.
Anyway, all right.
I've got a couple left over from corporate America.
There you go.
But you got it.
Mine is silver.
Oh, it's platinum. Come on, don't.
It's a regular Burl Ives song here.
Palladium.
Big rock. Palladium.
All right, guys, thank you for coming in. I really did enjoy them. I mean, this is conversations that we never have, and we need to have them. Disagreement is okay.
Yes, Mark. One more thing before you leave, Paul. I wanted to suggest, because we're going to be tonight on our agenda is to award the cell tower bid.
Ah.
So the next phase of that is to hold a joint meeting to discuss payment options. That might, if we could nail down a date or at least.
Well, yeah, I mean, we have to do it. I can't do it right now because I don't have the calendar.
That's fine.
Yeah,
might be a good opportunity for you to start this process of working together.
We need.
And it has to happen fairly soon.
And that's not necessarily going to be an easy decision to make.
No,
there are pros and cons to it all.
Sure.
Okay.
So maybe Mary Ellen can toss around. Maybe we can do a doodle poll.
Okay.
Or just do it at one of our meetings coming up.
I go along with that.
Yeah, let's do that.
Why come in a second time?
No. Right. I agree. I withdraw the doodle poll.
Interesting as the meetings are.
Neither is May or. It's an honor to be on TV.
Well, let's do it while Mark is still here.
While Mark is still here.
I would like Mark to be still here. So can we do it on the 31st?
Okay.
Thanks, Richard.
We can try out our
favorite. It's the day after Memorial Day.
Right now, I'm saying yes.
It's Tuesday night.
Okay.
We'll throw it out there and see if everybody responds. And
because I think it's important. Mark's been through the RFP process.
Yeah.
He's given it a lot of thought. He's talked to council on this.
Mm-hmm. I can tell you, regarding Mark, the finance committee is going to greatly.
We'll miss him, and I'm sure you guys will as well. But our loss is Richmond's gain, and good luck. And
thank you.
Hope to see you again. Thanks.
Thanks, Paul. Public comment. Anybody? No.
Cell tower bid award.
All I need you to do tonight is vote to award the contract or the bid to American Tower. They were the only fully responsive bidder, or I should say substantially responsive bidder, so that I can move the process forward.
It sounds like a no-brainer.
It's a no-brainer, but I need an official vote from you.
Okay, I move it. Okay, second.
Yeah.
Okay.
Done.
So the next step will be, like I said, to schedule a meeting to discuss your payment options, lump sum, or over a 10-year period.
Okay.
So I will contact American Tower tomorrow morning, let them know that they have been awarded the bid, and then that triggers their legal team and kind of opens the floodgates for them to get moving on it as well. So.
So with the joint meeting with finance, would we reach agreement on which option, or is that just to discuss? And
well, hopefully you can reach an agreement.
But is it something that's ultimately our decision?
It's your decision. It's your RFP.
Right.
It'd just be nice to reach it while he's still running the show.
Exactly. I would like to reach it that night. I know I have my preferences, but I would like to reach it that night.
We can talk about the options. We can talk about.
Good.
Yeah, I'll come prepared.
You have a 5 to 10 minute. Here are the pros, here are the cons of all the options. And then we can hopefully have a conversation about the best way. All right, town administrator search.
You want to take this one?
The ads were on all of the websites we discussed as of late Wednesday. We have 8 resumes so far.
Wow.
So that's a pretty good turnout. So we're on track.
Okay.
The search committee will meet Tuesday, May 31st in the morning, thankfully, at 9 o'clock, to do the first review of the resumes, and then hopefully they'll be able to forward someone to you for interviews the following week. So can I get some time frames or commitments to you in terms of setting aside time, the June 6th and 7th, it'd be Monday and Tuesday. Paul's got potentially jury duty, so it would have to be more in the evening from like 5 to 8.
Oh, 6, 7? What kind of days are those?
Monday, Tuesday.
When's the closing date for the ad?
May 27th. So okay, the search committee will be meeting on the 31st and that week to make recommendations. So I want to get interviews scheduled right away as soon as they make the recommendations.
And Mark's last thing is what?
I was going to wrap up a bunch of projects first. I don't have a date set yet, but I start my new position on June 2nd. So,
we need an interim.
Yeah.
A situation.
Yeah, that's. I'm going to talk about that in a second, but let's get the. God.
I mean, I'm not anticipating anybody, even if you guys meet the 6th and 7th, make a decision that week, make an offer. I mean, depending on the other person's situation, they will have to give some notice. So I'm not anticipating they're going to start much before the beginning of July. Of anyway. July.
What, so Paul, you've got jury duty, but what's prevent us from doing on the 8th, during the day of the 8th or something, as opposed to this, why are we tied to the 6th or 7th?
Just trying to
move things around, along. Right, I get that. Nitrogen is brutal right now.
The 8th is not good for me either, but it's...
You've got jury duty the whole week of the 6th?
I don't know. You know, there's a jury duty. I may not be called at all. I don't know.
Right. What about the previous week?
They're not going to make a decision. I mean, I don't know how much time they're going to need for them to make a decision.
I think it's Greenfield.
I mean, they're meeting the morning of the 31st. They may want to do interviews, they may feel comfortable moving forward, names along, and if that's the case, potentially we could do something. Wait, when are you back?
The 30th.
Okay, so you couldn't do anything before the end of the week anyway.
No, that's why I'm saying, could we do it like Friday the
3rd
during the day or something?
Maybe the 20, You mean June 3rd?
Yeah.
June 3rd.
During the day.
That's fine. It's okay with you.
Yeah.
Okay, that's assuming we make a decision. So, okay. So, then morning, afternoon?
Early morning would be better for me.
I'll block the day off at your disposal.
And that's okay with you, Jim?
Yeah, June 30th, it doesn't matter.
Okay.
Okay.
That's what, I just wanted some time to get interviews arranged.
Yeah.
Blocked off, so I will send you an email.
So that would be on interviews?
And these will be the winners of the first, the screening.
Right.
Right, okay.
Cycle, okay.
All right, good.
Okay, we are going to need an interim situation, and I would very much like to take advantage of the lessons learned from the last time around and suggest that we perhaps name Mary Ellen the interim. Mary Ellen said she's available.
Okay.
And she did a good job last time. I don't see any reason why we would go in a different direction this time.
Works for me. Okay, and can we add to that Mark's assistance on an hourly basis if she needs it?
Well, yeah, you would offer that.
I don't know where we stood. We talked about it last time, but I think Mark was going to, for one, see if his new employer had any problem with that, and I guess if he had time to do that, I guess I would like to.
Yeah, I'm happy to do that. I'll check with them, but I can't imagine they would have any problem as long as I did it outside of.
Didn't get in the way of what you got going on.
Right, exactly.
Yeah, I have no problem with, you know, with Mary Ellen doing interim, but at the same time, if she needs help or something comes to, we need crunch time to do something, and we need Mark's expertise to hire him.
Mm-hmm. Are we going to have the SCIM's RFP or response to the RFP submitted by the time you leave?
We're going to talk about that
later on. Okay. Next. All right. So, you know, effective on, when's your last day again?
I don't know. My start date in Richmond is June 2nd.
Okay, so at the very least.
Thursday.
At the very least, June 2nd is like a
Thursday.
Thursday.
Is it June 1st?
Okay.
Effective
June 1st.
I had to honor my 30-day notice.
If not before, then we'll talk about starting earlier if Mark turns tail and runs.
Well, he's going to be at least on the 31st, so.
All right, okay. So effective June 1st, make Mary Ellen the interim.
Sure.
Okay. Can I ask a pay rate, because I will need that for the minutes?
Last time
I did $25 an hour.
You got a beef with that again?
I don't have a beef with it. I did a lot of comp time the last time, and I got comp time I still haven't used, so I really will need $25 an hour in terms of the budget's going to get affected, is what I'm saying.
I guess I'm missing the.
Last time I took a lot of my time where I could to help the budget in comp time.
Oh, I see. Oh, no.
And I can't do that this time because I haven't used that time.
So, $25 an hour.
Okay. Okay. I just thank you. Thank you. I needed that.
If all of a sudden we find you working 50 hours, can you let us know that it's creeping up there?
Yeah. Trust me, I'll let you know.
All right. Okay. What else on town administrator? Anything?
Search?
Yeah.
No.
Okay. All right. Your updates, Mark?
I just have few quick ones here. Website update. The build out is ahead of schedule, so the majority of the department/board content has already been moved over to the new website environment. I can send a link to you guys if you want to take a look at that in advance. I'm hoping to have this project substantially complete before I leave also. And Mary Ellen's going to sit in on the next phase of there's checkpoints throughout this process, and we're on to phase two now, so she's going to sit in on that so that she's in the loop in case it does spill over at all. But it's substantially built now, so it's just a matter of kind of filling in the gaps, and then she'll know how the website functions and all that at that point. We do get training and all that included in it, but I'm trying to bring her. I wanted her involved in this process right from the start, so. And she has been. So.
Yeah. Okay.
SCAM's RFP is the only other thing, because we already covered Haydenville Road. The RFP has been posted. I did get a copy from Doug over the weekend, so I'm going to pass out to you.
It was posted last week, wasn't it?
Yeah, I didn't know until the weekend, so. Anyway, he did send it to me over the weekend. He just said he forgot to send it and apologized, but I don't think it's very different from the last version. So the due date is June 3rd, and I'll continue to work on this throughout the month and have a draft to you to review. June 3rd at 2 p.m. is the deadline.
Okay.
So
when does Deerfield think they're going to make the decision?
I don't know. I'm not even sure they know. But
well, just to clarify, it would be a recommendation from the SCAM's Board of Oversight to the Deerfield Board
right,
of Select.
Right, but Deerfield Board of Select
has to
make
vote
the decision.
On eventually, right.
Right, and if we do respond, we're on the hook for our response for 120 days.
Yeah. When you read this over,
I haven't read over.
You have not read it over.
Okay. No, I just got it on Saturday or Sunday.
Because you will be around on an hourly basis should we need you. But I think we need to make sure that we have a process in place for. Well, let me ask you: how much are you going to be involved in writing this, if at all?
I think Mark's going to.
Okay, so that means that the person who wrote this, should there be interviews or something, which is often standard procedure for RFPs, will no longer be with the town of Whately if there is an interview, if there are questions and answers that are posed based upon the responses. So I'm going to suggest that, Mark, you have someone, and I don't care who it is. I'll do it, Mary Ellen, whoever. Is your aide-de-camp on this to make sure that when the next part of the iterative process for responding to this and their selection is absolutely on top of every element of this.
Okay.
Because it's going to be really important. Because no one can say, oh, I don't know, I'd have to check the response. Well, bad answer. John?
The way the legal notice was in a paper, it seemed to indicate that they were only looking for proposals from within Deerfield. Are they willing to accept something from Whately? The very first line says within, in Deerfield or something to that effect.
Well, think better.
Well, that's what it says.
Where does it?
It says introduction.
The legal notice. That's in the town. And
there's clearly a preference for Deerfield.
For at least 3,000 square feet of building space in the town and land.
In the town.
It's got to be an 85% response rate. I mean, a response area, it's got to be able to respond. So I don't know where that is in terms of the 85%, but.
You could still do that if you were still in Deerfield, is what they're saying.
Well, having just gotten this now, I mean, I wish I could answer you, but Mark, can you run that by council tomorrow morning and ask that? I have no idea what the word I can't even pronounce APPURTENANT.
Appurtenant.
Okay. I went to a lot of school and don't know that word. Yeah, you need that. If that's.
They went 3,000 square feet. Yeah.
No, plus the garage. No, they're 3,000 minimum, I think.
Yeah.
No, including the garage.
Yeah. Building space on one end.
That's what they're asking for, 3,000 minimum. We have, what, 4?
Okay.
Right. Including the garage. It's funny, handicap access, not advantageous if you don't have it. It doesn't say it's a deal killer, it just says that it's not advantageous.
Am I the only one that finds that interesting?
Pretty much.
All right, you'll find that out and we'll go from there. I am assuming that your interpretation is not, but I get your question.
Just pointing it out.
Yeah, I appreciate that.
Where does it say it has to be in Deerfield?
It does, it just says that
which
for 3,000 square feet of building space first in the town.
First in the town.
And it's a Deerfield Board of Selectmen that are putting it out, so one would assume they mean within Deerfield. That's all I'm saying.
But we might argue otherwise.
Well, I mean, if that was put in there,
that's sort of a poison pill
for a number of different things. Okay, we'll find out. But again, we need an aide de camp. That's my only point. So let's keep moving.
Did you want to meet to move the draft?
Portion in, or what you know is aide de camp.
Aide de camps.
A what?
You had trouble with one word, but you got this other one that I think's like French.
French.
Parlez-vous français? All right. Police and fire insurance, or are you done with town administrator updates?
Yeah, I'm done with the town administrator updates.
Fire insurance.
All I need is a signature on this. We've already budgeted.
Just John?
Yeah.
Okay, do you have any other stuff that's not anticipated?
No.
Okay.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Okay.